Hello dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Mandeep Kaur, Associate Professor, Khalsa College of Education, Ranjit Avenue, Amritsar. Well students, today we will discuss about theories of educational administration. The objectives of this topic are to understand the meaning of educational administration, to classify the theories of educational administration, to discuss the different theories of educational administration, and to draw difference between different theories of educational administration. Now, first of all, we will discuss about the meaning of educational administration. Educational administration means to achieve the goals of education through effective and efficient manipulation of available inputs. It is concerned with the utilization of adequate resources available in the environment in order to foster the attainment of the goals of teaching and learning. It is always concerned with management of things as well as with human relationship based on a body of basic principles and aiming at educating the children and youth. It has to undertake a number of functions as shown here: planning, organization, direction, motivation, control, coordination, decision making, and the last one is reporting. It is a specialized activity which runs the entire educational program with fruitful and constructive goal. Educational institutions operate in a dynamic environment. The process of continuous improvement thrives when the mindset of the stakeholders is geared towards constant monitoring, problem identification, and research. It means that educational administration performs a threefold job to ensure efficient working. These jobs are: number one is stating the specific purpose, mission of education, and the last one is mission of institutions. Thus, educational administration deals with the optimal functioning of the institution by developing the human personality in a balanced manner. Now, student, let's start with the theories of educational administration. Administrative theories are discussed in the historical frame of four models as shown in the flowchart. These are classical organizational theory, the human relations approach, the behavioral science approach, and the last is post-behavioral science era. First theory is classical organizational theory. This theory came into existence during the early years of the 20th century. It deals with the formal organization and concepts to increase management efficiency. Major contributors to the classical organizational theory are Frederick Taylor, Henry Foyle, Luther Gulick, and last one is the Max Weber. Now, moving towards principle of this theory, number one is scalar principle, line versus staff. It means it refers to line of authority, unity of command. It involves receiving of orders from only one person. Exception principle, it involves delegate routine, task, and deal only with exception. Span of control, this theory is limited to number of people reporting to superior. That is the number of people can be 3 to 12. As shown in the flowchart, first of all, we will discuss scientific management perspective. This theory of scientific management is the brainchild of Frederick Winslow Taylor. This theory emphasizes on management of work and workers. In its simplest form, the theory follows the idea that there is only one best way to do a job, and that is to use scientific method. In his view, if a task is scientifically managed, it will increase the productivity by increasing efficiency and wages of workers. Scientific management in terms of time study standards, separation of administrative and employee duties, and incentive system would correct the performance of labors. The main features of this theory are, number one is, it finds out the best method for performing each job. It selects employees by using scientific selection procedure. Next is, it believes in having close relationship with management and employees. It uses division of labor. And last one is, it tries to produce maximum output by fixing performance standard for each job and by having a differential piece rate system for each job for payment of wages. This theory is based on certain principle. In the year 1911, Taylor gave four principles for scientific management. And the number one is scientific job analysis. Job should be analyzed through observation, data gathering, and careful measurement and management. Such job analysis will replace the old rule of thumb method. Second one is selection of personnel. Once the job is analyzed, next step is to scientifically select, train, teach, and produce workers. Previously, the workers choose their own work and train themselves. Next one is management cooperation. Managers should cooperate with workers to ensure that all work being done should be in line with the principles of science, that is the scientific method. Functional supervising. Managers assume planning, organizing, and decision-making activities, whereas workers perform their jobs. In the past, almost all work and the greater part of the responsibility were thrust on workers. Besides above mentioned principles, Taylor has also given two more principles of scientific management. First is performance standard. Taylor introduced time and motion studies to fix performance standard for bringing uniformity of work. We fixed performance standards for time, cost, and quality of work. As a result, efficiency of work could be compared. Second principle is differential piece rate system. Under differential piece rate system, a standard output was first fixed. Taylor studied that worker did as little work as possible. He felt that under existing wage system, an efficient worker gained nothing extra. That's why then two wage rates were fixed, and these are: low wage rate was fixed for those workers who did not produce the standard output. High wage rate was fixed for those workers who produced standard output or more than the standard output. By adopting such a system of wage rate, inefficient workers will try to improve their efficiency, and efficient workers will be motivated to maintain or improve their production capacity. Next perspective of the classical organizational theory is administrative management theory. Scientific management focuses on jobs of individual workers, whereas administrative management theory concentrates on the administration of entire organization. This theory is related to the issues of structure and management of organization. Henry Foyle, Luther Gulick, and Max Weber are the major contributors in the field of administrative management theory. According to Foyle, all managers perform basic functions of management, and these are planning, organization, commanding, coordination, and controlling. Beside the five basic management functions, Foyle has also identified principles of management, and these are division of work, authority, discipline, unity of command, unity of direction, subordination of individual interests, centralization, scalar chain, order, equity, stability of personnel, and last one is initiative. These principles emphasize chain of command, allocation of authority, order, efficiency, equity, and stability. Max Weber also recognized the importance of these factors. Luther Gulick, another classical theorist, coined the term post-COP. That refers to 7 functions of management. As shown in the diagram, these functions are planning, organizing, staffing, directing, coordinating, reporting, and budgeting. Now, let's study these functions one by one. Planning. It involves developing an outline of things that must be accomplished and methods for accomplishing them. Organizing. It establishes the formal structure through which work divisions are arranged and coordinated to implement the plan. Next one is staffing. It involves function of selecting, training the staff, maintaining the favorable and congenial conditions for the enhancement of professional efficiency of staff. Directing. It includes continuous task of making, communicating and implementing decision. Next one is coordinating. It includes all efforts that are needed to bind together the organization and in order to achieve a common goal. Next one is reporting. It includes verification of progress through records, register and inspection. It ensures that things must happen according to the planning. Budgeting. It involves all the activities that accompany budgeting, including fiscal planning, accounting and control. Moving ahead to the next theory, that is the critical educational administration theory. Critical educational administration theory assumes the existence of both objective and subjective knowledge of an objected and unordered reality. So, it incorporates the methodology of both the objective and subjective perspectives. This theory positing the existence of objective reality and subjective knowledge of reality. Reality is viewed as being in a constant state of change. Because of this change, laws are not sought by the critical theorist. Critical educational administration theory provides a mean whereby school leaders can understand and ultimately disentangle themselves from the external and internal forces which impose upon educational practice. As Hoy in the year 1994 clarified, critical theory attempts to raise people's consciousness about their living, working condition through logic and debate. But in the process, it relies on the generation or analysis of ideologies. Critical theorists elaborate the value and practice within schools which maintain the ideological perspective of schools. Topics such as curriculum, teaching and student issue display the inherent social values in the schooling process. Now, next theory is human relations approach. The human relations approach is considered to have started with a series of studies known as Hawthorne studies that have strongly influenced administrative theory as shown in the flowchart. Mayo and his associates were not only one the contributors to the human relations approach. There were a number of strong intellectual currents which influenced the human relations movement during this period. Kurt Lehmann emphasized field theory and his research was known as group dynamics. His associate concluded that democratic groups in which members actively participate in decisions that are more productive in terms of both human satisfaction and achievement as compared to authoritarian groups. The writing of Jacob Moreno made a substantial contribution to the human relations movement. Like Lehmann, Moreno was interested in interpersonal relations within groups. He developed a sociomatic technique. People have selective affinities for other people. Group composed of individuals with similar affinities for one another will likely perform better than the groups lacking such effective preferences. In the similar way, the human relations approach made relationships between employee and supervisors the most salient aspect of management. It advocates the training of people in behavioral sciences such as clinical social psychology to emphasize building collaborative and cooperative relationships between supervisors and workers. Two key aspects of human relationship approach are employee motivation and leadership style. The major assumptions of the human relations approach include the following ideas. Number one is employees are motivated by social and psychological needs and by economic incentives. These needs including but not limited to recognition, belongingness and security are more important in determining worker morale and productivity than the physical conditions of the work environment. An individual's perceptions, beliefs, motivations, cognition, responses to frustration, values and similar factors may affect behavior in work setting. Next one is people in all types of organizations tend to form informal social organizations that work along with the formal organization and can help or hinder management. Informal social groups within the workplace create and enforce their own norms and codes of behavior. Team effort, conflict between groups, group loyalty, communication pattern, and emergent leadership are important concepts for determining individual and group behavior. Employees have higher morale and work harder under supportive management, which lead to increased productivity. Communication, power influence, authority, motivation and manipulation are all important relationships within an organization. In this approach, field study methods as well as laboratory experiments were used to study the work environment and to understand the employees' behavior in the workplace. Now, let's talk about the next theory, that is the behavioral science approach. Behavioral scientists considered both the classical rational economic model and the human relation social model to be incomplete representations of employees in the work setting. Chester Barnard was one of the first authors to talk the behavioral science approach. He is best known for cooperative system, which refers to integrate in a single framework human relations and classical management principles. In the year 1938, Barnard stressed on two conditions of cooperation and financial success are to be attained. First, executive must emphasize the importance of effectiveness, which is the degree to which the common purpose of the organization is achieved. And second is, executive must be aware of efficiency, which is the satisfaction of individual motives of employees. In his view, an organization can operate and survive only when both the goals of organization and individuals working for it are kept in equilibrium. It means that managers must have both human as well as technical skills that are required for goal achievement. Beside Barnard, another major contributor to the behavioral science approach was E. White Beckett, who embodied a fusion process. Abraham Maslow and Douglas MacGregor are other general great contributors to the behavioral approach. In the year 1970, Abraham Maslow, a psychologist, advanced a theory of human motivation that was later adopted by many managers. Theory of Maslow was based on motivation and considered three viewpoints. First one is, human beings have needs that are never completely satisfied. Human action is aimed at fulfilling the needs that are unsatisfied. And last one is, these needs can be classified in a hierarchy from the lowest to highest. In this respect, Maslow identified five sets of human needs as shown in the diagram. These needs are physiological, safety, social belonging, esteem needs, self-actualization. But MacGregor brought a new perspective to the management and challenged managers to think of subordinates as responsible, capable and creative. He developed two theories, theory X and theory Y. Managers under theory X tends to be autocratic, control-oriented and distrustful. On the other hand, theory Y managers view subordinate optimistically as individuals who want to take challenges in their working environments, prefer self-control and are capable of responsible independent judgment. In this slide, Gregor gave assumptions on which theory X and Y are based, starting with the theory X assumptions. Number one is the average human being has inherent dislike of work and will avoid it if it is possible. Because of his characteristics of dislike of work, most people must be compelled, controlled, directed, and threatened with punishment to get them put forth adequate effort towards the attainment of the objectives. The average human being prefers to be directed, wishes to avoid responsibility, has relatively little ambition and wants security above all. And the theory assumptions are, the average human being does not have inherently dislike for work. People will exercise self-direction and self-control in the service or pursuit of objectives to which they are committed. Commitment to objectives is a function of the reward associated with the achievement. The average human being learns under proper conditions not only to accept but to seek responsibility. The capacity to exercise relatively high degree of imagination, ingenuity and creativity in the solution of organizational problems is widely not narrowly distributed in population. Under the conditions of modern industrial life, the intellectual potentialities of the average human beings are only partially utilized. As we have discussed about the theory X assumption and theory Y assumption, now try to differentiate between these two theories. In theory X, worker is lazy and dislike work. In theory Y, people are not lazy by nature, but the treatment in organization make them so. Theory X says workers are unambitious and avoid responsibility. Theory Y says they are more ambitious and they accept responsibility under proper condition. In theory X, they are not bothered about the organizational objectives. They should be directed. Theory Y says they will exercise self-control, self-direction need not to be directed. And the last theory, which is the modern theory, that is post-behavioral science era. In the view of Murphy in the year 2002, three interrelated concepts, that are social improvement, school improvement, democratic community and social justice, form the development of the next era of profession, that is the post-behavioral science era. The behavioral science approach influenced the preparation and practice of school administrators. Now, we will study three interrelated concepts one by one. First is school improvement. Accountability for school improvement is a central theme of state policy. The No Child Left Behind, it is NCLB Act of 2001, sets demanding accountability standards for schools, school districts and states, including new state testing requirements designed to improve education. For bringing school improvement, purpose must be clarified. The school districts and the administrators and teachers who work in it are accountable for students' learning. It means that what teachers teach and students learn is a matter of public inspection and subject to direct measurement. Second condition is encouraging collective learning. Setting state standards should be collective mission of the school and school district. It means it should not be one-man show. Aligning with state standards, tests conducted by states should be in alignment with their standards. Providing support to help all students to achieve high standards, teachers should be provided with the training, teaching tool and support materials. Last one is democratic community, which is based on the open flow of ideas that enable people to be as fully informed as possible. It involves the use of critical reflection and analysis to evaluate ideas, problems and policies. It places responsibility on individuals to participate in open inquiry, collective choices, and actions in the interest of the common good. Social justice, it is the core of democracy, in which every citizen is treated equally in social, economic, political, and educational areas. Excellence and equity are related to social justice. This is all about the theories of the educational administration. Now, summarize what we have studied. The development of administrative thought can be placed into a loose historical framework of four models: classical organizational theory, the human relations approach, the behavioral science approach, and the post-behavioral science era. The classical rational model evolved around the ideas of scientific and administrative management. The human relations social model includes experimentation and analysis of the social and psychological aspects of people in the workplace and the study of group behavior. The behavioral science approach was an attempt to reconcile disagreement between the rational economic model and the social model. The more recent post-behavioral science era includes the interrelated concepts of school improvement, democratic community, and social justice. Thank you.